the biggest story of the week, of course, was Mr. Bernanke's press conference after the Federal Open Market Committee concluded their two-day meeting just about 36 hours ago. There was talk of tapering, but we knew he was going to taper anyway. It was just a question of how much he would taper by and when. But the markets took it really badly. I mean, almost every asset class getting thumped. Let's discuss this in greater detail now with Jane Foley, senior FX strategist at Rabobank. She's on the phone from London, and in the studio in Cape Town with me is Brian Cantor, who is economist and strategist, Investec Wealth and Investment. Jane, I'm going to start with you. What an extraordinary time we've had over the last 48 hours or so.
Well, we have, although it's got to be said that looking at the European stock markets today, at least we have seen a little bit more stability. But of course, if we go back and listen to what Bernanke actually said, I don't think he said anything which wasn't common sense, which wasn't very pragmatic. I mean, what he said was that if the US economy is showing paces or building up momentum on its own, he will take the foot off the gas pedal. And he was very keen to reassure markets that policy or interest rates would remain at the very rock bottom levels until 2015. That's another 2 years of very accommodative policy. But the markets did react. We saw that yesterday. And I think the reason that they reacted so much was really, I think you can accuse the markets of really being quite exuberant in their tone over the first 5.5 months of this year. We saw real big gains in asset classes, risky asset classes, such as junk bonds, such as stock markets. And I think with the idea that quantitative easing will at some point be removed in the future, I think the markets are beginning to take a fresh look at those economic fundamentals. And there are still significant risks to global growth. And I think that suggests that the markets will be a little bit more realistic in the next few months. That means that they are going to be subject to volatility and to some potentially more corrective activity until the global growth outlook does improve. And that may not be until the end of the year.
Yeah, talking about exuberance over the last 5.5, 6 months, what about the exuberance over the last four and a bit years? Brian Cantor, the S&P has gone from 666 to its peak a couple of weeks ago of 1687. The Dow's gone from close to 6,000 up to well over 15,000. So it's been exuberant for a while. It's surely enough. And the QE announcement was sort of an excuse for the market to say, let's go back a bit.
Not surely enough at all. Off a deeply undervalued level.
Yeah.
If you do the numbers, the S&P looks to me quite undervalued.
Even
and
at
the
these
earnings
levels.
Earnings outlook is rather good. So to say that it was euphoric, I think that's wrong. I think it was off a really depressed level that you spoke about because of huge uncertainties about the state of the American and global economies. And that uncertainty has diminished, appropriately so.
Mm. Okay, Jane, just on that point, I mean, the divergence between the performance of the world's macroeconomies and the performance of certain stock markets has been quite startling. Here we have the ISM number coming out of China below 49, never mind below 50, below 49. The US ISM number, sorry, the PMI in China, the ISM in the United States of America also below 50. Unemployment still at an elevated level, 7.6%. To me, this is just the market saying we were expecting better macro fundamentals, so let's just come back a little bit. And I think the two will sort of converge at some stage in the next couple of years.
Well, I agree with that. And on top of those poor fundamentals that you've just described, of course, the Eurozone is in recession too. And of course, Draghi at his latest press conference said that the downside risks are still there for the Eurozone. So perhaps not before the end of the year will we see these green shoots in the Eurozone. With respect to China, I would say that the concern about the Chinese economy has grown over the last few months. Certainly, there is a spate of downward revisions from a number of forecasters with respect to Chinese growth this year. And with respect to the US, well, yes, we had decent data in the first quarter, but it does seem that Q2 will be slower than Q1. And in fact, we may not get a reacceleration of US growth towards the end until the end of the year. We've got to remember there's a lot of fiscal consolidation going on in the US. And whilst you may have differing views, of course, about the stock markets, you know, look at junk bond yields. Was it really justified that we'd see junk bond yields coming down as low as they have done this year, given those global concerns for growth? I would say that there was a lot of euphoria in those markets, and they did need a taste of reality to bring them down to earth. And Bernanke has done that, right, both in May the 22nd and his, I think, pragmatic comments earlier this week.
Brian, you were sighing away there when Jane was speaking.
I think you've got to appreciate the S&P 500 has been a distinct outperformer. The emerging markets, including South Africa in dollars, has been distinct underperformers. If you go back 2 years, emerging markets were quite demandingly valued, and the S&P was undemandingly valued. The news out of emerging markets, China, Brazil, maybe India, South Africa, has been disappointing. So the markets have reacted to that unexpectedly poor economic news. In America, the news has been unexpectedly good. And the point about Mr. Bernanke's statement was it was represented the Fed's view, which was very optimistic about the outlook for the US economy, talking about 3 to 3.5% growth next year. And his policies are conditional upon that. It was unexpectedly good news. One can understand why the bond markets would have reacted as they did to unexpectedly good news, meaning additional demands for capital, higher yields. Why the share market took such fright at higher bond yields, that I think is the puzzle. Because unexpectedly good news about an economy, yes, it means higher interest rates, but it also means better bottom line, stronger earnings growth.
The reason that the market reacted so badly was because of a number of factors. One of them was, and I'll bring you in on this one, Jane, was that I was speaking to somebody, I've mentioned this on the show, but I'm going to repeat myself. In the 1950s, when Brian was applying his trade first in the stock markets, the average holding time for US stock was 4 years. It's now 14 seconds because of HFTs and algo traders. There was something wrong and it needed to come back. To me, 1687 on the S&P was discounting 3 to 3.5% US growth, which Brian was just talking about.
Well, you've got to go back.
Just let Jane have a go,
right,
Brian.
Right. Mm.
Okay. Well, to be honest, with respect to the US economy, I would really question the statement that there's been unexpected good news. Yes, Bernanke is looking forward to growth next year, but he this year has been warning about the pace of fiscal austerity in the US this year. It has been really quite rapid. Now, if we take apart some of the US economic indicators that we've had this year, look at the labor market. Yes, you've seen unemployment come off its highs, but if you look deeper into that, we've only just had the labor force participation rate come off a 37-year low. If we look at the very broad measure of US unemployment, that's the U6 measure, unemployment is at something like 13.8%, which is really very high. So I would say that Bernanke is still waiting for the improvement. Hopefully by the end of the year, we will get the stronger reacceleration of growth in the US, but Q2 data in the US is not as good as people hoped it would be at the start of the year.
Jane, thanks for that. Just stay with us to hear what Brian's got to say. Brian, we've only got 45 seconds.
Yes,
can you manage
the one,
that?
The Thank big you. Difference between the previous Fed statement and this statement was remove the degree of downside risk. Mm. So objectively, I think that says the Fed has been pleasingly surprised by the state of the economy. But I think the important point here to recognize that Bernanke correctly is reserving judgment. He's not positioning himself for strong growth. If strong growth as he occurs as he hopes, then the quantitative easing will be tapered off.